service this morning. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Our focus today is on Jesus as our Good Shepherd and the care he provides for us. It's Good Shepherd Sunday. And I have a few announcements for us this morning. Immediately following the service, down in Sartorius Hall, we will have a congregational meeting. We'll be making a decision today about the little parking lot that's over on Southwood. So attend that if you can. Wildflower Walk is coming up on Saturday. If you're able, sign up for that so that we know how many are coming. Photos. We have been seeing now in the bulletin for probably some months now the invitation to have your photograph taken for a new church directory. We need to get those photos done. If you haven't had your photo taken, if you haven't brought the family in and all of that sort of a thing, please make that arrangement. Get those photos done so that we can have that in the new directory. We want this in connection with our 125th anniversary. And then last of all, I want to talk about the Daughters in Christ Banquet that we have coming up on May the 13th. You can read about that on pages 18 and 19 in your bulletin, but I have a special request from the men of the congregation. While the ladies are sitting at the table and having their banquet, guess what the men need to help me with? We need your help serving. We'll need your help cleaning up. So I'm going to be getting a sign-up sheet, or you can even tear out one of the pages in the bulletin there, drop it in the offering plate with your name on it, saying that you'd be willing to help and to serve on that day. But that's coming up on May the 13th. Please donate up your time as you're able. With those announcements made, we'll have the ringing of the bell, followed by our opening hymn. God bless your worship this morning.
Thank you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. The congregation may kneel. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess unto thee that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against thee by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore we flee for refuge to thine infinite mercy, seeking and imploring thy grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who hast given thine only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins. And by thy Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of thee and of thy will, and through obedience to thy word, that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, hath had mercy upon us, and hath given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgiveth us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he giveth power to become the sons of God, and bestoweth upon them his Holy Spirit. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, O Lord, unto us all. The congregation may rise. Make a joyful noise unto God, O ye lands. Alleluia. Sing forth the honor of his name. Alleluia. Make his praise glorious. Alleluia. 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 Say unto God, how terrible art thou in thy works. Through the greatness of thy power shall thine enemies submit themselves unto thee. with you. Let us pray. Almighty God, our good shepherd, who showest to them that be in error the light of thy truth, to the intent that they may return into the way of righteousness, grant unto them that are admitted into the fellowship of Christ's religion, that they may eschew those things that are contrary to their profession, and follow all such things as are agreeable to the same. Thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Ghost, one God, world without end. Please be seated. Our first reading is from the book of Acts, the second chapter, beginning at the 42nd verse. And in this reading, St. Luke is describing the fellowship of the early Christians. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Here ends our first reading.
And the broken dream.
reading is from St. Peter's first letter, the second chapter, beginning at the 19th verse. And in this reading, the apostle is describing the example of Jesus as our shepherd and overseer. "For this is a gracious thing, when mindful of God, one endures sorrow while suffering unjustly. For what credit is it if, when you sin, you are beaten for it, and you endure? But if, when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls." Here ends our epistle reading. We pray our gradual responsively. Alleluia, alleluia. Then was the Lord Jesus known of the disciples. Alleluia, I am the good shepherd. Gospel according to St. John, the 10th chapter, beginning at the first verse. In this reading, Jesus describes himself as the door or the gate to the sheep. "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who does not enter the sheepfold by the door, but climbs in by another way, that man is a thief and a robber. But he who enters by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the gatekeeper opens. The sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but they will flee from him, for they do not know the voice of strangers." This figure of speech Jesus used with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So Jesus again said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, I am the door of the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved, and go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." Here ends the gospel for today. We confess the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We sing our sermon hymn. Please be seated. Please rise. The text for our message this morning is from the Acts reading, chapter 2, and focused on verses 46 and 47. And day by day, attending the temple, together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. This is the word of God. Please be seated. Well, in the 1960s, a fellow by the name of Dr. Maxwell Maltz, he was a physician, he was a surgeon, he came up with a rule or a principle that it took 21 days to form a new mindset after one had surgery. He'd watched his patients and watched what was happening to them after their surgeries, and he decided that it took 21 days. He went on the speaking circuit and spoke all around the country sharing this idea, and it has become for many a cultural myth. A cultural myth, because researchers have looked into this principle, this 21-day principle, and they have found that, well, things are not quite that simple. Things are not quite that short or sure. If you want to change bad habits and form good habits, it will likely take more than 21 days to make all of that come about in our lives. A number of you have heard me say this across the years. I'll say it again till I'm dead, probably. Good things take time. Bad things you can do immediately. Okay, that is how it is so often in our lives. We need to cultivate our new and good habits day by day. And in our text this morning, St. Luke is listing out good habits, good practices of the early Christians, the behaviors that set them apart and made them different. And we're going to walk through five different things that Luke lists out. He actually lists more than that, but we're just going to focus on five this morning of things the early Christians did day by day in their lives. And the first one is this. It says that they attended together. They came together, and the place that they were gathering, Luke tells us, is the temple courts there in Jerusalem. Think about what these people have gone through. Some of them have had that life-changing experience of following Jesus, and with Jesus' closest disciples, they have left their home region of Galilee, and they have moved down here to Jerusalem, and they are abiding there in those temple courts. It's a total change in life for them. And then in Acts chapter 2, Luke describes others. These are people from all over the Roman Empire who had gathered together on the day of Pentecost and heard the word of God, heard the gospel of Jesus, saw the disciples receive the Holy Spirit, and they stayed and were baptized. They're there living in Jerusalem and attending together with those other believers in the temple courts. What a life-changing experience they have gone through. They've given up their former lives, quite literally, and Luke tells us even their property. They were selling their property and using the proceeds for the support of God's people, those who had come from so far to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. The importance of gathering and being together as God's people. And this is the reason, folks, why we have increased the number of our fellowship practices here at Emmanuel. God's people need time together to encourage one another, to support one another in their lives, like that flock of sheep flocking together to follow their shepherd, to follow their Savior. So we need time, day by day. And the blessings of God flow from that time that we spend together. And Luke goes on to tell us a little bit more about what they were doing. The second thing that he says is this, that they broke bread, he says, in their homes. There's something special about sharing meals with one another, coming together and having that experience. And if you've been coming to some of our fellowship events here at Emmanuel, you know just what I'm talking about. Some of the home Bible studies, when we get together, people will bring in things to share, things to eat, to have that time of sharing after the Bible study together. If you've been to a Holy Smokers meeting, that's all about eating. Quite literally, we have that fellowship meal together with the meat prepared, and then we open up our Bibles and we study a passage that is about food in the Holy Scriptures together. Game night, we're eating. Kids night out, we're eating. It's a wonder I'm not a bigger pastor than I am. But it's just a blessing of God's people being together. When we eat together, we learn to care for one another. When we enjoy that time of fellowship, we learn how to be generous and caring with each other, gathering like those sheep, shoulder to shoulder, day by day, with the people of God following our shepherd. If you start reading the research about family life, one of the themes that comes up again and again is the benefits and blessings of family meal time. When the family sets aside time to sit down together and enjoy a meal together. And the researchers don't quite understand how all of this works, but it shows up in the good traits and characteristics of families. Families that have blessing in their lives and things are going peaceably and well with the children, what they often find is that those families are taking their meals together. There's something special about that togetherness, drawing together and sharing that meal, that is such a blessing to our families, to our congregation, even to our community, as we share in the abundance of God's care. The third thing that St. Luke says about these early Christians is that they received their food with glad and generous hearts. And I might have tucked this under the other one about the breaking bread from house to house, but I think there's something a little bit different here in what Luke says, because he's focused in on their attitudes. Their attitudes. How they are thinking. How they are seeing things. On one hand, they are glad for the things that they have, the blessings they have in life. In other words, they're offering thanks, and they've got thankful hearts toward God for all that he has done for them in Christ. And on the other hand, he says that they are generous in their hearts, that they're sharing not just with one another but with the people around them that bounty of Christ is abounding over into the lives of others. And all of this is forming a bonding experience of the people of God come together in his blessing, and with that good attitude. What long-term effects do you think would follow if, well, we gathered together and we were unhappy with one another and we went out of our way to let each other know it? What would be the long-term effects? Would that build up the congregation, or would it tear the congregation down? I think you know it's going to tear things down. It would be worse. There's no worse outcome in our lives than having that bad attitude that makes us mean to one another, being mean to one another. That would divide the people of God. And Luke is showing us here by his description of the early Christians that God wants us to have that blessed attitude, to have glad and positive hearts, to have generous hearts in the way we see one another and care for one another. The fourth thing that St. Luke mentions here in the passage is that they praised God. They praised God because the Lord was doing all of these wonderful things in their lives, and through their lives, they offered up their praise to their God. They expressed it in worship and in singing, offering their praise to our Lord. We're going to hear the children sing here in just a little bit after the sermon. We're looking forward to hearing them expressing their praise to God and their thanks to God for the blessings that He gives. Well, this is a habit that we need to cultivate in our lives, of offering thanks to God, offering thanks to Him for the things that He has done for us. And you may have noticed this as you've been around me. There are certain things that I say and express that do this. I'll say things like thanks be to God or praise be to God when I hear good things and see good things happening in the lives of my people or in my own life. I've cultivated a habit of speaking that way. I didn't come out of my mother talking like this. I had to work at it. I had to work at it. And this is how it happened for me. I was studying one time some of the hymns of Pastor Luther, and I came across this communion hymn of his called, O Lord, We Bless Thee. O Lord, We Bless Thee. Unfortunately, it's not in our hymn book, but it's a lovely communion hymn, and as I was looking at it, I decided to read it in German. And when I did, I discovered that the opening words, well, the hymn translators translated a little bit freely. It literally says, praise be to God. Praise be to God. And I picked up that phrase and I thought, that's a beautiful way of putting things. And I will often say that, God be praised, or thanks be to God, when I'm talking with people and I hear something good in their lives. And that comes from Pastor Luther. And yet, not just from Pastor Luther. Because as I've studied that hymn, this is the other thing I've learned about it. Luther didn't write the first verse of the hymn. He actually picked this up from medieval Christians. It was written in the 14th century. In other words, Luther heard other Christians speaking this way, expressing themselves this way, and adopted it for himself and has passed it down now to others, including myself, to have that joyful, thankful heart, to offer praise be to God for the kindness and mercy and love that He constantly shows us in the Lord Jesus Christ. Cultivate this attitude of praise that the early Christians had, offering their praise to the Heavenly Father. What a blessing. Blessing as we share our worship together, as we share our food together, as we share our lives together, like those sheep walking side by side, shoulder to shoulder, following our Good Shepherd day by day. The fifth thing that St. Luke says here about these early Christians, well, it's not so much a habit of them, but a reaction that others have to them as they observe them. He writes that they had favor with all the people. Favor with all the people. As God showed His favor, His kindness, His love, His mercy to them, other people noticed how this was affecting and changing their lives. The favor and kindness of God caused other people to see them with favor day by day. Imagine the blessings that would flow if people would recognize in you and me that work of the Lord in our lives, the evidence in our habits, our behaviors, our attitudes, our words, and our deeds. After trusting in Christ, after receiving His Holy Spirit, this is what flowed and overflowed from the lives of those early believers. And the scripture says the Lord added to their numbers day by day. That blessed life in Christ is like a magnet drawing people together, like sheep drawn together, following the train of their shepherd. Well, there's both a blessing here and there's a bit of a challenge as well, because the truth is that when people come to us, new to the life of the congregation, they don't come in with all of these different attitudes and behaviors yet. Not necessarily. Okay, they may, but often they do not. And if we're honest with ourselves, we would have to admit that we don't always have these in our lives the way that we need. And the way that we should, we need that favor of our good shepherd day by day to guide us and to bless us, to change our behaviors. It's going to take more than 21 days, folks, to reshape our lives, to conform them to the image of our Lord Jesus Christ, to follow in the way of our good shepherd, and the Savior of our souls. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We continue with our offering. Take our silver and our gold, not a mite would we withhold. Take ourselves and we shall be ever only all for you. Amen. Let the children come forward for getting ready to sing. much. Albie, I think they found a new song for us to learn on the guitar.
Yes.
I have a question for you kids. Look around the sanctuary here. Do you know where the Good Shepherd window is at Emmanuel? There's a Good Shepherd window. Say again.
It's back there.
It's back there. It's back. Oh, Zach is waving to us from there. We're going to walk back there and look at the window. I picked up a microphone so that the congregation could hear. Oh, and there it is. So you'll hear me as I'm talking to the kids. Follow me like a sheep following a shepherd back. Here we go. And you'll see down here, what's in this bottom pecan corner? Water. Scripture in Psalm 23 talks about the living water flowing for the sheep that are in pasture to receive our good shepherd Jesus. So the next time you're here at the church, come out and have a look at this window. There's lots of detail in that window to explore and lots of symbolism to learn. And with that, you can snap and head back to your seats. We continue with our altar prayers using this responsory. I will say, set our minds on heavenly things. The congregation will reply, fill us with your joy. I invite the congregation to kneel. Lord Jesus Christ, as we break bread and pray the prayer you've taught us to pray, fill us with glad and generous hearts, that our family of faith may grow, the needs of others may be served, and a sense of awe may come upon us through your love. O set our minds on heavenly things. Heavenly Father, when rivers flood, tsunamis kill, hurricanes rage, and the earth quakes, remind us of your green pastures, your still waters, your comforting shepherd's rod, your presence in our darkest valley, your table prepared, your cup poured full, and your eternal dwelling place open for us, so that our souls may be quieted and restored. O set our minds on heavenly things. Holy Spirit of Almighty God, when our hearts are troubled and we feel wrongly accused or punished, remind us of the healing wounds of Christ, the Shepherd, the Guardian of our souls. O set our minds on heavenly things. Lord Jesus Christ, our Good Shepherd, give us an ear to hear our names being called to come home to your fold. We may live lives of abundant courage and faith. Be our gatekeeper, O Lord. Open up all that we've locked out from you out of fear, out of selfishness, out of shame. Enter our hearts as we come into your fold for your sake, for our sake, for the sake of one another. We'll set our minds on heavenly things. We intercede this day, dear Lord, for persons in need, Latavia Anderson, Jack Ashcraft, Jesse Barker, Gwen Boston, Tammy Kane, Lily Cunningham, Shirley Dickinson, Judy Edmonds, Adrena Espin, Lynn Garner, Sandy Garner, Jim Harper, Patty Howard, Joe Justice, Betty Kraft, Grant Marwin, Kenny Martin, Owen, Randy Potternoster, Teresa Richards, Abel Shostoff, Margaret Stevenson, Sherry Wiley. Touch these lives, O dear Lord. Strengthen them. Give them clarity of hope. Give them gladness of heart in Jesus. We pray for families who have lost loved ones. Family of Bob Laird, of Richard Stedman, family of Mary, Denny Malloy's sister, who passed from this life to your nearer presence. We ask, O Lord our God, that the joy and comfort of Easter, the promised resurrection and the life, would strengthen them through this time of grief. Pray your blessing for the following households of Emmanuel. Prosper them, O God. Stedman, Stevenson, Stevenson, Steer, Steitler, Stolzenberg, and Strand. They may walk as sheep in your sheepfold. We ask your blessing on those celebrating birthdays. Daniel Maynard, Brian Martin, Robert Strand, and Alex Engelbert. Give them joy in your good gifts. And for the anniversary of William and Gwendolyn Bostick, O God, give them that joy and peace, the bliss that our first parents enjoyed in Eden. All of these things we come before you praying as Jesus has taught us, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give thee peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Be sure to greet one another as you depart, and please rise for our closing hymn.